unbelievable talk, great presentation. My disclosures really aren't pertinent. So this is basically that slide, and you can just sit and talk about this slide the whole time. Essentially, when you're talking about deformity in the cervical spine, we're talking about kyphosis. And really, it comes down to two big things that we do. One is how we operate on people and who we operate. And John's talk, I thought, was excellent. It's not just local kyphosis. It's also global balance. And I think one of the things that I've done in the last year or two is I get a lot more 36-inch cassettes because I think that's helping me decide how to operate on people, what to operate on, and it's changed my management. And we'll go into that a little bit. The second issue is technical problems. And, you know, I think we have gotten better in different things that we've done using proper operative technique, going anterior when the patient is kyphotic, using our instrumentation better. You know, when I was a resident, we used to do tons of three-level corpectomies. I haven't done a three-level corpectomy in a long time. So I think by changing our strategies and understanding multi-segmental fusion versus a corpectomy is probably a good thing. And the second thing besides that is our patients. We have to recognize which patients are set up for deformity. I like shriek when I see the Parkinson patient walking in my office. And I probably diagnose more patients with Parkinson's than most of the neurologists at Jefferson. I think it's really important that those people, you get them treated, you get them on their meds before you even consider an operation. And we'll talk about that in a little bit, too. So, just basic biomechanics, what are we talking about? Cervical spine is a little different than the lumbar spine and the thoracic spine. Why? You have a lot of your lows put down posterior portion of your spine. Almost two-thirds of your weight is carried through the posterior portion of your spine. And why is that important? I'm a big believer of anatomy. So if you look at the cervical spine, the facet joints, they're very hard to get any other deformity. It's almost unheard of to have a cervical scoliosis. Why is that? Because when you look at the motion, you don't get a lot of axial rotation in the subaxial cervical spine or even lateral bending. Everything's flexed and extended. And it's because the facet joints, you can see them on the right, they're 45 degrees. And so you're just going through, backwards and forth. It's sort of like the analogy in the lumbar spine, L5-S1 spinal thesis. You only see it at L5-1 if there's a TARS fracture. So I think we have to understand that when we're talking about our patients. So pre-op assessment, very, very important, and understanding who we talk about. And John, great. This is Chris S. in this paper. And if you're a junior resident or a senior person and just want to review, this paper is in Journal of Neurosurgery by Chris Dane. It's a great paper. And it really goes back to teaching us, you know, stop looking at the tree, back up, look at the forest, and understand patients' entire balance. Because a cervical kyphosis in some patients might not be incorrect. It's actually playing out. Alan Hillebrand, years and years ago, wrote a paper about people with scoliosis. And if you look at the scoliosis patients, you notice most of them actually will have a little kyphosis in their neck because they lose their entire thoracic kyphosis. So recognize this. I get plain things on everyone, and there's multiple etiologies. I'll argue the biggest person, the biggest creator of deformity are the people in this room. So be careful. And again, it's a cascade. Once you do something, and this is where I'm kind of excited that you know, my patient population is all very old people, and to know a third of people out there are psychotic, I mean, it looks like I'm in business for a little while. Because what happens is that gravity continues to put your head down. You lose your posterior spines, and it's a complete cycle. Particularly if you get neurologic involvement, and then you lose the innervation of your posterior spine. So, again, cervical deformity goes back to improper positioning, removing aggressive decompression, which we don't do that as much as we used to years ago. And our instrumentation is much better. The second thing is, I always get nervous when I'm doing the C2-3, doing a laminectomy and the residents are exposing. Because the C2 musculature is very important. And sometimes you come in there and you're like freaking because they're like, oh, I thought that was C3. You're like, oh. But we'll go on. Pre-existing cervical kyphosis, a bad problem. And again, it should be how you approach it. So really carefully. This is, again, my typical patient, 700 pounds. You can't find the neck. You get an x-ray, you get to see C2. And so I always position my patient, and I always I never let the resident position the patient and come in the room with them and break. Because I think that's probably the biggest thing we can do. But it was the posterior approaches are much more, we have much more problems with them than the anterior. The second thing I do a lot of times is I will also do my procedure, and at the end, I'll give the patient more lower doses, meaning that give decompression and then release the head and bring the head back. This is Dr. Albert's patient. Thank you, Todd, for the slide. Don't fit people in kyphosis. Instrumentation can't overcome every deformity, so be very, very careful on that. Again, we talked about the musculatures. I'm going to go through here. Instrumentation, again, plating. Someone mentioned it earlier, John. You talked about allograft versus autograft and about plating. I don't think we have an answer on that yet. But I do think plating systems have helped us, and they do prevent this here. And again, this is the paper about we created a lot of kyphosis in the old days with our corpus communication. Laminectomies, it's amazing. I still see post-laminectomy kyphosis in the Philly area. I don't know where they're coming from or where or why, but it's not that uncommon that I see one. I probably see two or three a year. Who are they? Usually adult sites, and by far, wide recessions, and again, the highest risk group are young people. Age, if you're doing a child or a younger person, be very careful with how much you decompress, and you probably should consider instrumenting them. Why? Because again, here's a 3-year-old that someone took had surgery, and it looked like a letter C, which is bad. So what do you do? The good news about kids is you put them a little traction, they have to go right back. And again, not to do your patients, your collection. I've stolen a lot of Dr. Albert's slides. It's basically what I do. I guess, Todd, you might create more deformity than I do. Patient factors, really quickly, we'll go through this since I have about a minute left. Unrecognized spine trauma. This is a classic patient comes in, they have a small fracture, and they have a ligament injury. And what happens? The CC junction kind of gets ignored. So be very careful. But one of the groups that I see not that uncommonly is an ankylosing spondylitis person. Any ankylosing spondylitis person with pain has a fracture until proven otherwise. So that patient gets aggressively worked up and treated. And actually, usually we get some post-operative work. Here's another ankylosing spondylitis patient. Again, not the greatest MRI. Had an epidural hematoma, as you can see. Unfortunately, they did a laminectomy with gut instrumentation, and that didn't work out very well. Lastly, a subgroup of patients, which I think we don't appreciate that much, is the spinal cord injury patients. When you get a neurologic injury, you denervate your posterior muscles. And as you do that, you tend to kyphose. So I tend to be much more aggressive on this population than other populations because one is they like to be a little kyphotic because usually if you're a quadriplegic, you're in a chair, and so they like to stick their head out a little bit to use the straws and things. But if you don't fix them like that, they tend to fall over. So let's be careful. I do anterior posteriors often on that population. And this is my last slide. But the last group I talked about, this is an interesting paper. I think Chris Ames is on it, Chris Jaffrey, where they look at Parkinson's population, and what they saw is that there's a lot of myelopathy in the group, but they didn't necessarily tend to have a cervical kyphosis. Parkinson's patients tend to have a thoracic kyphosis and a thoracolumbar kyphosis. So be very careful when you're operating on the Parkinson's patients and understanding what you're doing and what your goal is. I find these are the hardest patients to operate on, and I usually try to not operate on them if I can. Thank you.